Danielle Potter.
Hello, everyone. How are you guys? Well, you know, I've spent, ever since I got this book, I've been reading it. And what occurred to me while I was reading it was that in due time, we all experience venturing from home. For some, it's quite easy. For others, it's just the opposite, and that was the case with this poet. She left her home of Chukri, Ohio for Louisiana, over a 1,000-mile trek, and yearning for the embrace of home, she wrote of home, and in writing, she filled the gaps that the miles had created. What began as an act inspired by homesickness has evolved into the collection of poetry we are all here to celebrate tonight. Only The Church in the Plains is more than a book of poems. It's a woman examining tendrils of roots which first began with the growth of the German Lutheran immigrants. Immigrants who came to a new world not knowing what to expect, but hoping for something far better than they had left behind. But do not be mistaken. These poems should not be taken as textbook history. Far from it. They should be taken and understood as stories of what had been. You turn the page and a sliver of history evolves as Reinhardt envisions it. We see the immigrants on the ship, the reaction to Lincoln's assassination, an old woman baking funeral pies, and hear the story of a rat and an uncle I sincerely hope she reads tonight. Her poems do all the essential things any poem should, any poem strives for, really. They make the hairs on the back of your neck stand on end, and you'll swear your heart shifted in your chest. And they're only able to do that, mind you, because together they accomplish something so human, it's impossible to put a name to it. They're a reminder that in order to put down roots, we must first be uprooted, and the rest is history. Everyone, it is my pleasure to introduce to you our 2016 Philip Levine Prize for Poetry winner, Rachel Reinhardt.
Thank you, Danny. That was wonderful. and thank you to everybody who had anything to do with the Philip Levine Prize, especially Peter Everwine, Connie Hales. Thank you, John, for taking us up to the Sequoias, Jefferson, who's, I think, outside. Thank you. So I'm going to start with a poem, the first poem in the book, which is called At Death, Luther Dreams of the New Country. And in this poem, Luther is, you know, he has gone back to his hometown and he's dying. And I was thinking about how the New World was recently discovered. And so I'm imagining him sort of thinking about this possibly on his deathbed. The epigraph is, "They are trying to make me a fixed star. I am an irregular planet." Having begun this note at Eisleben, they're returned by some strange umbilical tugging and forced to quit for chest pains a little after 8. I am ugly at my end and rude, Katie would say, though she is far off. Sometime after midnight, they try to heat me with cloth and kettle. There is witchiness in these curious ablutions, as if hot towels will stay apoplexy or the heart's jutting hemorrhage, as if death were not an animal tearing out. Whether coming or going, one cannot reach eternity except through a film of salt spray, the sea slaps still reverberant in the ossuarial ears of the faithful, the innate echoing suck of the spirit lapping at the face of the deep. Tonight, lonely immigrant, I will kick off from my bedship and wake tomorrow, brine stinking across this elsewhere, my pen beside me like an excised claw. I will journey inland and find office in an empty barn stall, in a country uncloistered and uncowled. St. Anne has no providence there, though lightning drips down thick as bee stings. In the orange after storm glow, someone is assembling church doors, someone across at a fence post, these to house the great hushing amens. Oh, to wake there and say, where now Melanchthon and his star charts, where now his great fish that thrashing in the firmament, the planets tossed and buoyed in its wake. There can be no heaven without a little grief for the old way. Where now, my Katie? This next poem is called After Easter, 1865. I don't really remember how I encountered this, but Lincoln's funeral train came through Plain City, which is the town closest to where I grew up, and it was called Pleasant Valley then. And I was sort of thinking about how slowly news traveled then, and how the people who lived there wouldn't have known immediately that Lincoln was dead. And then I, you know, sort of went from there. So I have a husband and a wife. When he has put up his horse, he finds his wife in the hearth light, boiling her monthly rags. 12 days it's been since Easter, since they woke in murk to ride 9 miles to the settlement for sunrise service. 12 days since they fell back, instead hungry into the quilt. And when, in the aqueous pre-dawn light, he propped the Bible against her sacrum and read De Evangelium, his German clotting in the sunrise, she swore she saw the angel sitting, look there, on the stone in the pasture. They did not know it, Lincoln then, already cold. He waits. In the flickering, in the flecked foam, he recognizes a scrap of gingham. Last he saw it cupping her hip before the war. It vanishes in the souse and sop of this night chore he has never witnessed. How often men and women go separately to their violences, rife each with private deaths. Later, he will tell her about Pleasant Valley, sparked and silent, the low-bellied train squatting in the shifting glare of bonfires, the flower-glutted track, the catafalque car. But now, remembering the gingham, he must have her. Even in ashes, even with his little English, he must have her. The scent of blood rises in the wood smoke. The trains late resume their schedules, their long whistles core out the night, exposing that raw, abraded place where worlds scrape together. When it is over, she will go again to boiling. And then the title poem of this collection, The Church in the Plains, I drew this title when the group of Germans that my ancestors were part of immigrated to Central Ohio. They first established a church in what was, they just called it the Church in the Settlement, and later a group broke off and built a church about 9 or 10 miles away, and they referred to that as the Church in the Plains. So I sort of stole that and used that to create a world for this collection. So this is kind of out of that. Seeing it is nearly 9 miles to the church and the settlement, they entreat the father to dwell first in the rafters of the one-room schoolhouse, later in the rough-hewn belfry of the new white church. There they gather to thank God in the familial tongue for aquifer and loam, for infant son who will farm these lands yet not ancestral. For Magdalena and Matilda, wives who steam fresh snow in their kettles when the pumps freeze. They ask for Sunday evenings that burst slow and easy as the bubbles in their warm brown beer. There they gather until letters from the old country cease amid news of war, and the final echoes of boot clonk Deutsch dissipate over the plains until the last boat lists in the celestial estuary. Its passengers, old women reluctant to shed the body's unseemliness, its dry rot and insidious fever. Old women reluctant to leave off their habitual shooing of the angel of death. They gather until the old women depart, the church beneath them seeping a new country light. They gather until the grandmothers are gone, dies Großmutter who cannot learn to pray in a new tongue. This next poem is called Epithalamium for a Feral Child, and epithalamium is traditionally a wedding song sung to the bride on her way to the bridal chamber. Don't really know where this came from, so I'm just gonna read it. They have listened at your throat for root sounds, sought the Ur language in your heaving grunts and sharp barks, but you are only a corn farmer's unsanctioned experiment, your teeth rotted and rank with bitch's milk. Once they kinned you to a boy, needle-boned and reared in his father's aviary. Seeing you, he winnowed and chirped for his finch mother, his robin aunts. They tore you from his neck in a spray of inexplicable feathers. Yet you charmed the youngest anthropologist with your lean haunches and swinging breasts, the way words glance off your shoulders. There is, of course, shame in it, the wanting what nature has not prepared for want. And in his furtive pleasures at your messes, your spine bowed, your quiet straining in the corner. During the ceremony, you chew nuptial lace, swallow seed pearls like pill bugs, and sniff at the preacher's crotch, your hackles subdued in a froth of taffeta. You will not be the first to enter the bridal chamber on your knees, your nails clouded and clicking the tile, nor the last to nestle afterwards at the foot of the bed. This will become your routine, nightly the splitting of thighs, monthly the measuring of your dark estral skein. Though you prefer raw things, things steaming still with life, he would wither you on greens. Though you can skin a rabbit with your eye teeth, he will prod you to radishes. You will sink into the yard at night, slink into the yard at night, fatten instead on worms and frogs, and once an ias storm-blown and keening for its mother. When you cease returning for suppers, he will cease to let you out. For days, you will sleep dizzy on stacks of field notes until you wake one morning, your nostrils thrumming with the scent of his jugular. When it is over, they will find you in the yard, crouched behind rusted scales, jawing your husband's skull, sucking greedy his white-shined bones. When out of fear, they abandon a leather muzzle by your mat-thick head, know this, it will be worth the belly full of buckshot. This next poem is called Vulpecula, an answer, and that's a constellation that is not always visible in the northern hemisphere. It kind of dips below the horizon in the fall, I think. And Vulpecula is the fox, and answers is the goose. Before dawn, a vixen sweeps the empty fields between a tree stand and the little creek, bearing only the strange stink of estrus and a dim, wintry hunger. Far off, a tod abandons his prey mid-chase to follow her, seeking flurry and steam, the nebulous vapor of copulation. Indifferent then to the goose and the hazy jaws of her star-shackled semblance, she courses after a sluggish possum. Her teeth graze the rabbit's high-flung scut, as kits slink unnoticed into her belly. Faint star, she burns low to the horizon, her sated paunch dragging the firmament of another season. She keeps no record or lineage, carries no memory of her mother, her only aesthetic, the sharp pleasure of scent. What to her is starry simulacrum? In the first light, a farmer fingers his shotgun and relents as she ignites, red streak, wild glint, luminous, dazzling the world of snow. And I wasn't going to read Uncle Ernie and the Rat, but I will, since Danny asked for it. I really did have an uncle who went out into the corn crib and a rat climbed up his pants, and he had to, you know, drop them. I changed a few things for the poem, but part of it really did happen. Uncle Ernie and the Rat. When they tear down the wire corn crib, my mother seeds in us a story that begins with a pants leg left untucked. She tells how Uncle Ernie, maybe days from breakfast beer or just sleep slow and wandering the empty cribs, didn't see a thinned out corn rat seeking his meager meal. Uncle Ernie in the blue dawn, blue before dawn dark, heard his tummy grumble and sat down to think his wife a widow, his itty baby shrunk to bone in her cradle. His eyes salted up and he wanted to cry, but then he felt a little tickle creeping up his left leg. That old rat, a little lost and terribly hungry, lit out for the territories of Uncle Ernie's pants. And so the story ends with the tank of a belt buckle in morning mist. See, my mother says how even in the leaner years, a grown man with a rat in his britches will still drop trout and laugh. Listen how the kernels clatter around him like teeth. This next poem is called Burning the Old Store. And out in the country, when buildings, you know, barns, houses, things like that, you know, for a while we sort of let them sink into the earth. But eventually when they become unsafe or just totally unsightly, we call the fire department out to burn them. And this is usually a pretty big deal. People, you know, neighbors come and watch and see what's going on. And there used to be a store beside the church that they did this to well before I was born. And so this poem kind of grew out of that. As widows, we remember it now. When the fire brigade came out at first light to burn it, the red sun blown in over busted tubs of bag balm and petroleum jelly, glistering in bottles of expired soda over straw strewn for kindling the evening before. We were children then, our mothers towing us bleary and shivering, our fathers already in the milk houses. The fire gnashed on quickly that morning, the engine ready, the men posted sleepy at their hoses. When the two emerged, a man bearded with sparks, his face half gone, and a woman, flames clotting in her hair like nasturtiums, our mothers leapt first to extinguish them. He died in a quilt they threw over him, but the woman lingered, her clothes going up before her. The mothers submerged her in a cattle trough, blotted her charred skin with their dresses. Her breasts came away in their hands. They found her no name or town, she, quiet at the last, smoke tufting like wool under her nostrils, and cattle waiting around the trough to drink. My mother said she must have come off the train with the man looking for farm work. She must have jumped into the fields with her skirt bunched at her knees. The wheat that month was like sunshine for the threshing. They buried her in the churchyard in my mother's yellow dress, and for 3 days after they laid her to cool in the earth, our milk tasted singed, the butter as though it had been churned with ashes. This next poem is called A Kindness. Late, they find the heifer calf, the calf monster, bifurcated at the neck and dying two-headed in the grass. The heifer delivered of it will not nurse, even to relieve her udder. When the old man returns with the rifle, his granddaughter sits, the thing resting fever-eyed in her lap and sucking in each mouth her smallest fingers. He motions her away and kneeling cups a crabbed hand around the rifle barrel, but above the trigger, his finger ossifies. You must do it, he says to the girl, do it twice behind the ear and then against her shaking head. Really, it's a kindness. Indeed, the mother steams out past the pump, remembering her calf only for the lather and lingering soreness. Twice the girl circles the calf, twice against the night, the gun reports. This next poem is called A Buttermilk Bath. When I was in graduate school, I used to drive this old man to church. And he told me that on his, I can't remember where he'd gone for his honeymoon, but he and his wife had been sunburned so badly that they rubbed buttermilk into the burns, and I had never heard this before, so I put it into a poem. And after a sunburn, I remember Eileen in evening's kitchen with cold buttermilk, in a basin, my wife washing my raw neck and whispering, this will take the fire out. Her mind on the skin and its hothouse blooms, she remembered for me a quarantine sign and seven sisters vigilant outside her window. Oh, she said, how my hands itched even after they burned the quilts, smoke purling in the rinse of morning. Milk washed that night, we lay in the milk white sheets, I to cool and she to share the heat of me. In 1978, there was a big blizzard that hit the eastern Midwest pretty hard, and it hit, my parents got like 7 feet of snow, and there was a nurse who got buried in her car, and the way that the firemen found her when they were out searching was they could just see the tip of her car antenna to dig her out, and so that's kind of what this poem came out of. The evening of the third day, the nurse hears church bells in the back seat of her Cutlass. So long has she been banked, her windows occluded by snow, the cold crouched against her like a heavy cousin. This is what it means to surrender heat, to suck for thirst snow from muddy floor mats as whiteness swallows even the mad harping wind. She dreams her body a hospital closing down, the organs wink out in their corridors. Down halls through wards she tumbles, spirits bump in the haze of the neonatal ward. An incubator whines, its glass walls misted against the cooling air, the infant inside panting translucent. Night grinds on obscured, the incubator rhymes with frost, the nurse cups the infant's skull, its fontanelle soft and radiating heat. She warms, sweats. With one hand, she unclasps her brassiere, peeling away nylons like dermis. Her slip scalds in a puddle at her feet. Momentarily, she wakes, the car a crucible, the infant vanished, vinyl blazing against her navel. Above her, distant, for miles, only fields, only snow unfolds beneath the expanse. The car's antenna glints, hypodermic in starlight, in snowlight. The nurse rises. What is this white pattering of ashes? Oh, angel, oh. The next poem I'm gonna read is called Irish Malts. And when I was a kid, my mom used to make, it's the best way I can describe it is like curdled pancake. it's eggs and flour and fat of some sort. And she would put syrup on it. And it translates roughly, I think, from the German to eggs lard. so I was thinking about that. Deep during our last bone crack winter, after the heat lamp shattered and the chickens ceased to lay, my mother dragged one sodden hen into the laundry room where it shook the frost from its wings and commenced again to drop eggs and clean towels, gulping instead of clucking its grave photosynthetic need. Before church on Sundays, my mother in the kitchen beat the hen's eggs to yellow, the yellow into flour and milk, into hog fat, and my father bundled, roved to the cellar for peaches, the new barn for quiet, while I ate Irish malts curded and scrambled in the skillet and waited for him to reel in, muddled and dizzy with kerosene. And Sundays, hearing the light thirsty hen who told the same story, the kind of story my mother pocketed or slipped to compost beneath the sink, how once my father's father butchered a skinny rooster on the hearth, flame sparking a feather-flecked puddle, a corroded knife. In another room, empty jars glistened like ice in a sump, the heater and old sun roaring out. The implements of hunger and a hard winter, my father said, pulling a jar of peaches from his coat, spooning them cold, crystalline into dishes, fat cooling to ropey skeins in the skillet. We sat thawing peaches on our tongues. In a spring, my father said, somewhere on down the line, a man and his wife will take up that carpet and, seeing the wood floor stained, think of worse murders. this next poem is called Augury. I've always been told that when you find a bird in your house, someone is going to die. And so, what this is about. When you tell me you have found a robin in your house, a robin roosting on your pillow, and this in February, I know it is the omen you've been waiting for. At the sink, you wash out droppings and soft underfeathers, leave the cases to soak in a bucket. Up the road, the neighbor woman is dying. You say you cannot understand it, how God can devour a woman this way. For months, you've sent meals in Tupperware containers, jams to tempt her body to sweetness. Now she is like a child sucking juice from a dropper. Days disintegrate at last to juncture. There can be no medicine, only vigil, only hours shucked back as husks. Tomorrow she will be gone, gone in the night when the thaw groans slowly on, gone when the robin taps again at the window, thinking to secrete her egg in your sheets. The next poem is called Stanza. The word for stanza comes from the Italian word that means room or stopping place. And so I was thinking about how a poem is kind of like an old farmhouse that's been renovated and changed over the years. So it is with old farmhouses, chambered as hearts, each room its purpose. Upstairs, the new bride drifts between star-bitten windows, fusses again with the quilt corners. How deliberately she presides over wreckage, walls demolished and erected to suit. The back stairs sealed with their dangerous angles and boards worn slick from years of furtive scansion. Out of debris, a cradle planed, a new table. After bedtime, the children crouch on the cold floor and peer into the kitchen through antique registers. Now, in the empty house, she swats at old ghosts with a straw broom. She does not startle at the scent of the hearth in the wrong room or a child laughing in the coat closet. When the aging farmer can no longer manage his ascent, they move the master bedroom downstairs. Though he is gone these 20 years, the widow still sleeps there, her sometime kung cry hushed and tinkling above her. The next poem is called For Mutt, Tish, and Poogie Pum, which my grandmother was one of eight siblings, and these were the nicknames that the youngest three sisters had for each other. And when Mutt died, you know, they kind of, it hit them really hard, so I was sort of thinking about what it's like to lose a sister after almost 80 years. For Mutt went on in the last days of December, the oldest of the youngest sisters, who remembered most the cold and splintering seat of the privy at night, the shock of frost as she scampered bare-ankled across the yard, and alighted in the dark closet to the abrupt scent of wood and earth and excrement, her nightgown tucked up over her knees, the door propped open toward the bright naked lamp of the moon. Snared months later in the dim clamor of the ICU, Poogie Pum turns in the trappings of later years. In the mechanical sibilant, she hears instead the butter churn scraping rhythms, its crank worn to Tish's cramped hand. A fester skulks along her body's humid corridors. Her heart hearing flaps uneasily on its stalk. Sometime in the early hours, in the broom and spell of fever, Mutt comes in again, ornery from the yard, and wedges her cold knees into Poogie Pum beneath sheets across decades. Off to the east, prefab houses rise up in rows, even an anonymous as teeth. In one house or another, a dog sleeps beneath a desk in what once was a bedroom in a farmhouse in a cornfield, before that a bog or cathedral of oaks. And the dog shifts, snorts in a breath of all that is left of that bedroom where the youngest sister slept, expelling again those ancient swept molecules of shared air. Now, in the dark, girlish sobriquets dissipate over the telephone wires and the frayed boundary of earthly realms. A trio of widows at the end, they toss in the expanse of their own beds, each reaching to warm the other and to Mutt lying now with her cold knees in the earth. Over the old privy, someone's hydrangeas gorge on quicklime and bygone night soils, tipping their blithe and lustrous heads into the dawn. The next poem is After Orville. My grandmother used to have a tenant house before the fire department came out to burn it. And there was an old man named Orville who lived in there, and he had a glass eye. And we would go and we would take the paper when we were like, my sister and I were like 6 and 7. She would send us across the yard with the paper so Orville could read the paper. And I was just really obsessed with his eye. So 20 years later, here it is. The autumn after a snarl of blood vessels burst in my father's brain, my grandmother sent us through the yard after school to the tenant house with last week's tribunes. These we traded Orville for fudgesicles wrapped in wax paper and pulled from the freezer in the dank mudroom as Orville's eye skidded awry in the dusky light. 7, I knew better than to stare or ask. My grandmother, vague, said he lost it in the war. I imagined bayonets, gouging, deliberate, easier to conceive than the fluky trajectory of shrapnel. Our trade complete, we glutted under the clothesline and the spinster aunt's gusting dresses. October, we glimpsed the check curtains in Orville's kitchen, and also Judy, who had returned fat and pleasant to his table. My grandmother did not know if they were married then or ever. Judy, 20 years his junior, was to us still old and doughy, immune to scandal. Evenings, my mother stayed late at the hospital. We slept back to back in the farmhouse's cold upstairs, the aunt's snores creeping low through the walls. I dreamt of Orville's eye, of Judy polishing the sham iris with her nightgown, setting it to gleam on the bedside table, the eyelid's sleepy implosion over the empty socket. When Orville died 8 years later, Judy had gone on again, left him to wane in the dim lonesome of the tenant house, its ghosts too itinerant and renting. After the burial, we entered the house, witnessed the stifling dust and mouth shit. The toilet cracked, its rim vibrant with mildew, rust browning the sink. I dug for the eye, lucent, orbiting, I hoped, the crusted bathroom cabinets. For a few years after the fire department came out to burn the house, the aunt grew pumpkins in Orville's garden. Far into the fall, they lay on their vines like sunken pates. What an awful thing to rent in old age, to own at the last only the clean earth of your plot, sod sealed and settling, and a false eye bereft of its swaddling tissues, dislodged and resting blind in the stony bowl of your vacated skull. The next poem is called Lunatic Time. That comma is doing a lot of work, I hope. Otherwise, it's a kind of a crazy dance, sounds like. Which is not what this is about. Sometimes, seeking desperately the measure of her weeks, she dresses now for church on Tuesdays or Saturdays, slides sideways into the slick interior of the Oldsmobile. So familiar the route, the car seems to know it, nosing its gentle way like some peculiar landbound fish, and she leans in its belly as it makes its one wide turn before the church. But dim, the sanctuary withholds its promise. She sits in the pew, hymnal poised, waiting for the organ to thunder out of its immaculate, peatless slumber. Churchgoers flit in her periphery, but she cannot fix them. The long dead lingering beside her flee when she turns to greet them. Even the eyes of Christ flash impenetrable in the soft flesh of stained glass. Lunatic, time loops and tangles, doubles back on itself. Somewhere in the hours, the pastor appears, or the woman who fills the candles. They call her son to collect her. Behind the scrim at her window, she baffles in the horrors of her dotage. Someone has moved her husband's truck. It has been only days and decades since he slumped dead against the dash in a hay-flecked shirt. The chicken coop, too, is missing. The pasture fence, vagrant memory like livestock loose over the plain. Always, night obliterates. In the morning, she will gather her pocketbook and go again to church, searching still for some low-lit beacon to mark her faltering way toward the long home. The next poem is called Whirligig. I wrote this after a kid that, who was my sister's age, he went to the church school when we were there. He died in a car accident. Every year, the hour of your death wheeled round as it must do, and it passed you as you slept or kept some late night watch on an aircraft carrier or under the languid paddle fan in your bedroom. But that is not how I remember you. Toe-headed and freckled, you whirred and buzzed during chapel, our teachers pleading with you for silence. And this is how I imagine you in your final somersaulting trajectory, the burst of glass, the clangor and screech as the telephone pole sheared your SUV in two. Did you live to witness your body's last wild arc, the vibrant rush of stars as your jacket billowed behind you? They said that when the paramedics discovered the inexplicable helix of your guts, they dug through viscera, searching for a second face or set of hands, a companion. But you kept for company only a tiny imp, caroming and hungry for throttle and the heady spin of exhaust. Did your mother wake then in the stillness of her age and brew her coffee in the dark as some bleary anchorman cast the first news of your anonymous death? She must have huddled to her cup, savoring the hazy ache of remote grief, the horror looming over some other mother, while you lay yet in the asphalt's unrelenting cradle, tepid with the residue of yesterday's sun, with only the gush of gasoline and radiator fluid, the tick-tick of cooling metal to sing you on. The next poem is called Cessation. Lutherans believe that after the last of the apostles died, there were no more miracles performed, which is something that I've always, it's kind of struck me as odd, because we do still talk as if miracles are happening. So this, I was just kind of trying to reconcile that with this poem. After the ascension, absence built in the disciples' ears like pressure as they performed the last miraculous acts, these of healing and killing both, of gentle resurrection, even their shadows washed potent over sick beds. When the Romans sentenced him to death, Simon Peter requested to be crucified upside down, so not to die as Christ, so not to leave earth upright, but humbly, feet first. So also to ponder his hard-horned feet, once washed by Christ, once buoyed on the Sea of Galilee. Peter was old then, twice as old as Jesus, his beard salt-snarled, sweat shimmering over his flame-like pate. Finally, the cardiac fireworked, the seamed musculature of the heart burst. So it was the end of miracles. All bound in heaven loosed, a great silence rolling upon and over the earth, the open space of the plains. Now our prophets are merely epileptics, the Bethlehem star not auspice, but a matter of perspective. Yet you will find argument in the tight corners of country kitchens, where God is even in the leavening. For every dog dead on the road, another limps home, and the cock escapes the fox's jaw to crow a third time. When the paramedics arrive, a 15-year-old girl is already crowning in her grandmother's bed. How great and terrible this jostle and parting of atoms, this tearing of curtain flesh. There is mystery yet in mechanism, in motion. What teaches the body to know itself, to trust its violent thrusting instincts, Like Christ, we too crawl into an ever-weltering world. And the last poem I'm going to read is the last one in the collection. And I took the title from a verse in Matthew 24, which says, "For as the lightning cometh out of the east and shineth even unto the west, so shall also the coming of the Son of Man be. For wheresoever the carcass is, there will the eagles be gathered together." And eagles is often also translated as vultures. And so in this poem, I was kind of thinking about how the church and the land around it is coming into the 21st century. Wherever the carcass. How quietly now the schoolhouse gives up its sentry, resting humped, vestigial on the church's spine. For years, the pipes beneath the boys' urinals emptied nowhere, an ammoniac sump seeping at the foundations, the well corrupt, poisonous. So it is the creeping way of hardship, how it festers like mold in the primers and catechisms. There is no one left to tell them they have forgotten the old ways, only widows doddering at the coffers to whom they will not listen. This is how the spirit descends, not as a dove but a kettle of vultures funneling the updraft. Round the steeple they plume and settle, make their roost and vernal quarter. They will not be rid, so it is. The young pastor teeters on the roof, strings of compact discs and cowbells looped and clanking against his clerical collar. The birds, serene, shift easy in their bulk and do not dazzle, though Sundays the bells clamor above the benediction. Amid the glittering cacophony, the pastor baskets greasy feathers. In a shed behind the parsonage, he sows rudimentary decoys, splashed at first with corn syrup and food coloring, later with chicken blood. The vultures blink, the threat lost on sometime cannibals in any way the carrion counterfeit. His wife will not have him for the stink. Electric wires hum in his dreams and the pop of birdshot, but law, being with the birds, forbids it. So it is. Come a Saturday evening in spring along a road that curves between the field and a creek, skinned with ice even in April, a farmhand and his family turn over their Bonneville. In the morning they are dead, the mother threaded through by tree limb, the father draped over a toddler, an infant blue in its car seat. The headlights wink and peter out. Near dawn, two great birds alight. One nestles in the mother's lap, picking at the bloody skin behind her ear. It is almost a kiss. The other sidles to the infant. There, pausing, it tilts its meaty head, troubled not by breath sounds, but a faint, milky scent. When the ambulance arrives, sun glistens over the asphalt. The second vulture curls still around the infant, tucking the head under its wing. The paramedics prod and shout until it rises. Beneath it, the infant, pristine, gathers her face and squalls. The vulture scuttles to the ditch and begins his labored, flapping ascent. The lights flash, the siren screeches, far off, the wind-whipped Kyrie rises on the plain. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Thank you.